Welcome to Future Explorations. I'm glad you can join us. My name is Victor Martinez, and this podcast is dedicated to the exploration of the diversity in perspectives around the concepts of change as a constant we humans need to embrace, long-term thinking as an approach for everything we should build and create, and the limits that our human nature, physiology, society, environment, and technology impose on us by their own intrinsic characteristics. It is your task and mine to identify the connections between all views, to discover the interdependence and complementarity of knowledge and ideas. In that way, we might get a clearer picture of what that sustainable future could look like and how we can design the transition to get us there. Today we have the honor to talk to Dr. Eva Noyola. Dr. Noyola obtained a physics degree at the National University in Mexico and a PhD in astrophysics at the University of Texas, Austin. She has lived and worked in Mexico, Canada, Germany, and the US, doing vast amounts of public outreach to varied audiences. She has appeared in two documentaries, as well as multiple media interviews in print, radio, and TV. Dr. Noyola created a new method to measure surface densities in resolved stellar systems, which is still state of the art. She published a catalog of surface densities for galactic and satellite globular clusters, which is getting used and cited over a decade later. Dr. Noyola also discovered evidence of the first intermediate mass black hole in the Milky Way, and was part of the team discovering most of the candidates to harbor intermediate mass black holes in Milky Way globular clusters. She was part of the team who found out that most Milky Way clusters rotate in their center, and coordinated a survey of dark matter searches in small galaxies, which is still yielding results today. Okay, so we are here now with Dr. Eva Noyola. So thank you very much for joining us today. It's a great honor.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for inviting me.
And I would like to start by asking you to introduce yourself a little bit, to tell us a little bit about yourself, what's your professional career has been like, and where you are right now.
So I am an astronomer by profession and trade. I got my PhD here where I live now in the University of Texas in Austin. After I graduated, I spent some years in Germany working at one of the Max Planck Institutes for astrophysics there. And then I spent a couple years in Mexico City, coming back to my undergrad alma mater in UNAM. So I also worked some time there as an astronomer. But eventually the lure of the siren of beautiful Austin called back and we came back here. So I joined as a research scientist. I joined the university again already some years ago. But right now I am exactly when I'm transiting from academia to the private sector, essentially. I'm about to start a new job as a data analyst in a company. Okay. So one of the things that I plan to tell people is that I will cease to be a professional astronomer, but I will never cease to be an astronomer. That will always stay with me forever.
Absolutely, that carries in the veins. But in astronomy, what research you were doing in specifics? What projects you were working on?
So I brand myself as an observational dynamicist, which translates to I go and gather the data myself in telescopes, whether they are here on the planet or in space. I've done both. And I try to figure out the dynamical situation of a small galaxy, for example, different objects, but some of them are small galaxies, by measuring how the stars arrange themselves and move within the galaxy. So that is the broadest way to explain my work.
That's what okay, I mean. No, that is excellent. Thank you so much. So there in the podcast, I will be interviewing different experts, but I will be touching the same three topics with all of them. The idea is to find how, different perspectives actually connect.
And these three topics came from you know, many years of my own research and the literature review that I've been doing in the last few months. These topics continue to pop up again and again. And I hear them every time more often, people talking about them, because it seems that they are key to really understand how can we develop as humans in the most sustainable way. So these topics are change, long-term thinking, and limits. And I would like to, you know, first discuss it as a very conceptual high level, whatever is it that those mean to you. And from there, we will try to, you know, get into more detailed conversations. But started with change. For an astronomer or observational astronomer, what does a change mean?
That is a fantastic question, because there are few things in astronomy that change in the time scale that we humans, and by we humans, I mean the whole of humanity, let alone me, like one person or one generation, right? Things change very slowly for the most part, which is one of the reasons why some of the phenomena that change visibly, obviously, clearly, while we are, you know, alive, like in the lifetime of one person, are so exciting. So people love like supernovas, because those are literally within days, there's this spot in the sky that gets super bright and then dims, and people can actually observe it changing. The other one would be, I guess, stuff in the solar system definitely changes. People can see a comet come by and then leave, mm-hmm. or asteroids do things, you know. So that sort of thing we can see, but almost everything else, we only measure change by ensemble. Like we measure how galaxies, we know that galaxies form isolated and then they smash into each other, because we see some galaxies in the process of smashing, and we see them at different stages of this smashing, right? Some are getting very closer, some are beginning to strip a little bit of material of one another, some are in the middle of literally crossing each other's disks, things like that. So it's just by ensemble. We don't see these processes as they are happening, because the timescales are ridiculously long. The other thing is we unlike almost every other area of science, have a time machine. It's built in into the nature of our work, because since light has a finite velocity, the further away you look, the more time has passed, and you know that. So sometimes we measure the way galaxies evolve by looking at the ones that are further away, therefore younger. They are in a younger stage than the ones that we look that are nearby. So we have a built-in time machine in the universe in a way, right?
Yes.
We are forced to do archaeology in that sense. Well, no, I'm saying it wrong. The universe has a built-in time machine because of the distances. The archaeology is what we do with the nearby things. Sometimes we can trace with chemistry and dynamics, which is what I do, the way things mm-hmm. move. You can try to wind the clock back and figure out what things were doing some billions of years ago because of the way they present themselves now. Right? So for us, the concept of change is very, very different than for almost anybody else in that sense. We live off snapshots, we live off a lot of inference, we live off a lot of model. A lot of the things that we figure out is we try to model and match to what we're seeing, because we don't have clocks to play with.
Yes.
Directly, right?
Yeah, so one of the things that I've been reading in the field of physics is precisely how things are measured, and that sometimes the measurements that are being made are so extremely small. But then, as you said, no, as you mentioned, the idea is then understand how that even if it's a extremely small change, you can determine, you know, direction, speed, and different things, and then mm-hmm. you can extrapolate that into longer periods of time, and then we can infer these changes. If you allow me, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm thinking in the audience that not everybody understands, and not everybody is an expert in this field. So the analogy I'm normally trying to explain is with the idea of the universe expanding is mm-hmm. a balloon. Now imagine you have a balloon. Yeah. The balloon is in a dense concentrated space, and then you start blowing, and the whole thing starts growing. Basically, all the little particles of air inside the balloon, we can imagine them as galaxies. And the more you inflate, they separate. I know it's not perfectly right because you are increasing the amount of molecules inside the balloon, but let's imagine that that same amount stays there, and therefore the distance between those molecules expands. No, like that analogy could more or less work.
I love that analogy. The part that most people tend to miss with analogy is that you have to stick to only the surface of the balloon. That's the only part of the analogy that works. The stuff in the middle of the balloon is not the universe. The universe is only the surface of the balloon. I need to extrapolate this analogy to three dimensions. So instead of being a surface, it's a volume that expands.
Yes.
But it is a perfect analogy in that sense. You don't care if there's more molecules inside because somebody's blowing air. That is not part of your universe. Your universe is only on the surface.
That really blows my mind.
I know that's how the analogy works. So that's why when I say that astronomers try to measure, for example, the curvature of the universe, well, analogy with the balloon makes a lot of sense, right? The more it inflates, the less curved it is. Like if you start, it's something that is very, very curved.
Yes.
Well, if you keep blowing, it approaches a flatter surface. And if it gets big enough, you may not be able to tell it from if you're standing on it, you may not be like on Earth. We are not able to tell that the thing is round because it's big enough compared to us, right?
Yes.
So that is analogy. But what if the universe, instead of being like a balloon, was like a tablecloth, like a tablecloth in a restaurant that was made of balloon material and it gets pulled from every direction, right? That is a different universe than the one in the balloon. It has a different curvature. But from the local point of view, if you stretch it enough, it looks very similar. So it's a very different measurement to make, but you are stuck to the piece of cloth, to the two-dimensional thing.
So we are standing in a point of this tablecloth, and you can look farther and farther away, and the farther away you look is ancient, is older. I mean, because
it is, but the key to this, the single more interesting part of this thought experiment is that anywhere you look around the tablecloth looks the same. So that's what he's telling you. Whatever is happening beyond that, I haven't gotten the signal yet, but most likely it's not different to where I am. I'm not at the center of anything. I'm not at the center of the tablecloth or in any special place in the balloon. It's simply I'm looking up until where the signal can get to me. So that has to do with the limited speed of light.
Mm-hmm.
And I can figure out that I'm not in a special place in this thing that I'm observing. Like everywhere else seems to be behaving the same way and evolving the same way.
Yeah. Now, thinking of this time machine that you were mentioning, the farthest away that we've been able to see is being shown in this microwave.
Cosmic microwave background, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So how could we understand that imagery from the analogy of the tablecloth?
So from the analysis of the tablecloth, you start with a small tablecloth, the size of a napkin, and then pulling from every side, you know, it starts expanding. When it started expanding, you put a dot of, let's say, ink, and the dot of ink expands at a fixed speed, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's two things that are happening there. The dot of ink is expanding, and if you didn't stretch the tablecloth, it would still expand at some speed. But on top of that, you're stretching the tablecloth.
Mm-hmm.
So the blob of ink is getting bigger for two separate reasons. One is because the ink is expanding per se, and the other one is because you're pulling the table, right? So with that in mind, there is a finite amount of blob that each ink of dot will make, and that's all that we can see. Mm-hmm. So the tablecloth may be 10 times bigger than the blob of ink, or 100, or 1,000, or barely bigger than the blob of ink, and we don't know.
Yes.
Because that is as far as the signal allows us to see. See my point? Exactly. So I'm trying to explain that we are limited by the speed of light. In this case, that's the limit of the signals that we can get. But what lies beyond could be could be much bigger or not. and that's what cosmology deals with, essentially.
Yeah, and basically we don't really know if there is anything outside that edge of.
Well, what we know one thing. We have done good enough models to know that the Big Bang happens. At some point, we know that the particles are much smaller than atoms at the time that the Big Bang happens. there's a lot of thermal issues that occur, and eventually the particles start settling in more like the basic particles that actually form atoms. So there's quantum fluctuations at that point. Those are the ones that stay frozen in the cosmic microwave background. Mm-hmm. So this last layer that we can see is still, it's really early in the life of the universe. So we do have a pretty wide window. I mean, it's limited, but it is wide. So there's a fair amount of things that we can know about what was the universe like at that time. And we know that there's some time in between, and it translates into the, you know, stringy universe that we know now, with these filaments, with superclusters of galaxies and all this stuff. So the main work of cosmology is, well, they have several pieces of work to do, but one of the biggest pieces of cosmology is what happens between those quantum fluctuations that we can read off from the cosmic microwave background onto these filaments of galaxies. Like, what happened in between there? And we don't necessarily have signal all over the place for that. Like there's a big gap of time in between the cosmic microwave background and the first stars, literally, like big structures that start forming, right? Or galaxies or things like that. So there's plenty of work for cosmologists there.
Yeah, no, I
agree. A fair amount of work left to do.
Yes. And going back to the idea of change, from very basic understanding, what has made all this change happen? My first intuition will say energy, but it's not necessarily that the reason why things
happen.
You
know, another beautiful way to illustrate change in science in general, astronomy in particular, is when I was a graduate student or an undergrad student. Yeah, when I was an undergrad student, the universe was not expanding. It was expanding slowly, I would say. It was expanding because we knew that most things were redshifted. The universe only started expanding at an accelerated rate until I was already practically in grad school. So it was when they did this discovery with the supernovas, and they realized that blah, 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 and that this Einstein term was actually not only present, it was very important. It was actually dominating in the cosmological concept. So technically, the universe that was in the minds of astronomy or cosmologists when I was studying physics is different to the universe that we conceive now. Yes. There were some very important changes, and of course, the universe has been doing the same thing all along. It's just it took us a lot of observation and a lot of work and a lot of modeling to figure out that, oh wow, no, the models that we had were not taking a bunch of things into account. So yes. See my point, the universe didn't change per se, we did, and this will continue to happen. We will continue to changing the way we understand things. That's what science is about, really.
Yeah, there are two things that come out from there. And one we will touch it further down is the change that we have to understand what is going on. But in specific, the change happening in the universe. Expanding universe, stars dying off, and planets cooling down. And I don't want to jump directly into thermodynamics. Maybe I'm missing something. But my intuition as a non-physicist will say that if you want something to happen, whatever it is, you need to input energy. And I was told in school many, many years ago that, you know, energy and matter is what it is. No, what we know is out there is what it is. You cannot create it from nothing. So what is causing change in the universe? My intuition is correct. Is this amount of energy that is being used in different ways and is moving things apart and then is being dispersed and so on?
So I will give you... I'll let you in an insight that astronomers are horrendous at naming things. We have a horrible track record and we don't learn from it. We keep doing it. So the answer to your question, to that thing that you're looking for that is driving all this change, is dark energy. That's the name that we have given to this thing.
Which we just learned about very recently.
Literally 20 years ago. Well, technically it had been formulated as a theoretical possibility since Einstein and other colleagues already over 100 years ago. But technically, we found observational evidence for it just 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. So I think the name was probably inherited already. But my point is, it's it's not a bad name in the sense that it's so obscure, and we don't have the faintest idea what it is. The faintest. So at this point, we are saying like, okay, there is this thing, this term in the equations that we call dark energy. And all we know is that it makes the universe expand in an accelerated way. We have no idea where it comes from.
Okay, so again, thinking in an audience, if I understand correctly, you have different bodies in the universe, in space, you know, stars, planets, galaxies, mm-hmm. and they have a gravitational pull and mm-hmm. makes things move around in a specific, precise way that, thanks to many really bright people like you, we have been able to calculate, and we know how they move and we know what's going on. But through these calculations, something was missing, something that we could not see was actually pulling things. So in order to make the equations work correctly, it was discovered in that way? Because the idea of dark matter is that we cannot see it.
There are two monkey wrenches here. One is dark matter and the other one is dark energy. And they're very different things.
I know.
I even skipped the first monkey wrench, which is, yes. I love it because it's something that I worked on. So I'll be happy to explain the basics of that. Not only that, because the fundamental people to do those discoveries, the first ones were women. And they have not been recognized the way we like to recognize scientists that make great discoveries. So I will take the opportunity to talk about Vera Rubin.
Please do so.
Vera Rubin is the first person that made, I would say, the equivalent of the supernova measurement that took a Nobel Prize. She made the equivalent to that, but in galaxies. And in that case, the discovery that she did was, you have a galaxy, you have beautiful photos in which you trace the amount of light there is from the center to the outskirts. And you estimate how much matter is there between, you know, just from the light, between stars and gas and whatever have you. So from that, you can make a model and you just say the velocity of stars moving in this galaxy should behave in this way, because this is how much mass mm-hmm. I have from mm-hmm. the stuff that I can see, which is gas and stars, right? And then she went and measured, and the velocity towards the outskirts was coming way higher. So she's like, there must be a mistake here. And she tried and she tried and she measured in a number of galaxies. And eventually it was clear that even if you accounted for gas that is harder to detect and that, you know, the molecular gases doesn't shine brightly, so you cannot detect that. But it's like, but it would take way too much. Like there wasn't any of the things that we know to exist in galaxies could account for such a large velocity. It seemed to, you know, there seemed to be some matter there that was producing gravitational fields that wasn't visible. And that's what got called dark matter. I would appoint that Vera Rubin never got a Nobel Prize, which is, I think, one of the worst calamities in science. She should have, she deserved it. That was her discovery. And again, it's not the first time it happens, but let's move on. So that was the first monkey wrench. And even though by now, I would say it is the consensus, the vast majority of astronomers accept and work with the idea of dark matter, there is still, it's fair to mention that there's a fraction of people that still think that we could have a modified gravity. Like gravity may behave differently than what Newton said at large distances. Mm-hmm. Unlike what Einstein did, which was modify how gravity behaves in short distances or in very heavy circumstances. What some people propose is called MUNT, like modified Newtonian gravity or modified Newtonian dynamics. It's wasting. What if when you go far enough, just the equation doesn't behave the way you expected it? And it's not that there's extra stuff there, but it's just that it behaves differently. And that's been an argument and a fight for many years. Like I said, the largest percentage of the consensus is on the dark matter is a thing. It's tough.
Yeah.
But there's still some people arguing for the other side. And the main sticking point, I would say, at this point is that there's still no good modified gravity that can describe what happens with galaxy clusters.
Yes.
Modified gravity is beautiful when you want to describe galaxies. They have models that are very, very general, very nice, and they fit things very nicely. They explain a bunch of scalings. But when you get to the clusters, they kind of break down and you go back to needing this extra stuff, which you might as well call dark matter from the beginning.
Yes. And you were mentioning also dark energy, which is different.
Exactly. Dark energy is a completely different beast because this thing, first of all, as I told you, what we want to explain with dark energy is pulling. It's making things move faster. It acts as mass, which is attractive, right? We know that gravitation happens when there's mass and it's attractive. Dark energy is the opposite. Dark energy is something that pushes stuff away, but in really, really, really large distances. This is not at the level of one galaxy, not even at the level of a cluster of galaxies. This is at the level of the universe, literally. You can only find out about this extra measurement, like the observational evidence for dark energy comes from measuring a million galaxies, essentially, and seeing how they arrange around each other. I happen to have collaborated in a project that is trying to do that here by measuring literally the position and the velocity of about a million galaxies. So it's a really hard measurement to make, mind you. But that is the evidence. So we have now the evidence from that, from how the galaxies arrange and move. Also from the CMB, it turns out that in detailed analysis of the fluctuations of the cosmic microwave background, mm-hmm. also needs this term. So now it's coming from several, and mostly the supernovas. The supernovas were the first thing that were screaming, saying like, wait, these galaxies are going away faster than they should if we didn't have an accelerated expansion.
So, okay, that's so fascinating. I would like to keep on asking that, but we need to move on. So just to wrap up, the idea of change, there is a popular saying that the only thing constant is change. Would you agree with that on these super huge scales?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Like, if anybody wants to come with a static model for, man, almost anything, I'm thinking from a cell to a molecule to a humongous galaxy, everything is changing.
Absolutely. Where does it fit then? I know this is a very deep, and it's going to take us a lot of time to probably discuss it, but what about the whole idea of entropy and thermal equilibrium? I think this here in this moment could fit the different theories of how the universe will move in the future or will end. Some mm-hmm. I know there are many, but what's your idea with that? As far as I understand, there is this tendency for the thermal equilibrium at the end.
So the issue is thermodynamics is, I think it was my favorite class as a physics undergrad student. It's a perfect, you know, framework, essentially. It's beautiful. It's, but it works where it works, and it doesn't necessarily work in other systems, right? So the issue is that thermodynamic works beautifully, I'm telling you. It is a sight for, it makes you almost come to tears at how beautiful it works for closed systems. And there are a number of systems in a lab and anywhere where you can reasonably well model something as a closed system. You can control the things that come in and out, and you know exactly. But in nature, you know, often systems are more complex than that. So by the time you get out of a closed system that is controlled, you start getting chaos and a bunch of other things. And you reach the parts of physics that we have not been able to describe thoroughly, because they are not a nicely closed system. For example, fluid dynamics, which is fascinating, is wonderful. It is very current these days with this issue with the mask and the ventilation and all of this. So it is vital for us to understand fluid dynamics correctly. It's not only a theoretical matter. We really want to understand fluid dynamics very well. But the equations to describe that thing are horrendously complicated. Like there's no way to try to do things without making a lot of simplifications. So my point with thermodynamics is, if you try to model the universe as a thermodynamical system, it is too complex and it is too large. Mm-hmm. So thermodynamics is useful in certain specific, either idealized or simplified ways, and certain simplified systems. And in some ways you can do it and you should do it. Like if you mm-hmm. take an isolated galaxy, well, yes, it will take it forever to exchange certain energy sources with anything else. It's isolated by itself, so you can use thermodynamics there. But if you want to apply it to the whole thing, it's too complex. At this point, I think we cannot quite run with it. So we use it mostly for specific states. But I think what you were asking is, what is the fate, ultimate fate of the universe, I guess?
Well, I mean, I know that there are different theories and they are based in different points of evidence. Obviously, just because what you just described is clear that there is no way of knowing for certain what is going on or what is going to happen. But from the different theories, what you can mm-hmm. share about, you know, the most logical ones or the ones that look like.
I may disappoint you with my answer, but my answer is more on a practical level. And as I did because I was raised like this, as an astronomer, is what you care about is something in the order of a Hubble time. A Hubble time is, you know, roughly the age of the universe. Therefore, anything that is 100 Hubble times, I mean, sure, it's an interesting theoretical construct, but as an astronomer, it's like so moot to me. Like the most that I can care about is the age of the universe, right? Once we go a lot, so one other Hubble time, interesting to work. 100, sure we could try, but. So the issue is what we know now that I think nobody would argue against are two things. The universe is expanding at an accelerated rate. And at this point, technically still being worked at and measured, but honestly, there's zero indication that there's enough matter in the universe to reverse that trend. That is what is called a closed universe, and there's different ways to describe it with different cosmological models. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line is that you need a certain amount of mass, and it could be dark matter or regular matter. And we don't have it even by a long shot. So I don't think that, even though that used to be one of the things that people call about the cyclical universe, that it expands and then it contracts and there's more big bangs and blah, blah, blah. I think the amount of matter that is required, we just don't have it. So I think at least those we can, for now, safely go like, unlikely, very unlikely. So let's assume that this thing indeed keeps expanding. The other alternative is would be not that it goes back, but that it the expansion slows and eventually it reaches, like in infinite time, it would reach a stationary level, like mm-hmm. stops expanding. But again, it's an infinite time. So we an asymptotic slowdown or something. And again, to figure out if we're ever going to be there, it may be that if they find out, if they do enough of these surveys with the millions of galaxies and they figure out if the dark energy changes with time, which is what we're trying to find out. Mm-hmm. At this point, we just got the signal that it's there. We don't know if it changes with time. If it was more powerful before and it's been going slowing down, that will tell us a lot of information. We're not there yet, but it might. Well, so it's in these cases in the infancy. And all of this is still many, 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 many whole times away, whatever consequence of this. So then do we focus more in like our galaxy, our solar neighborhood, our, right? And then there's specific consequences to that.
For sure. Yeah, we're approaching to the next two topics. So let's get to the next one, which I think connects perfectly, is the idea of long-term thinking. Mm-hmm. For certain very earthly issues, no, with humans in politics and in society, we are missing the idea of long-term thinking, and I don't want to dig too much into there yet, but again, from your perspective, from your understanding, what does long-term thinking means, or how do you work with it, and how does that relate maybe to the things that are more, you know, human-sized?
Yeah, so I think that's super relevant. Then we move to the other end of astronomy. We were talking more about cosmology. We move to the planetary sciences, which are more the, you know, we all love to watch those science fiction shows where people take off to the asteroid belt or to Mars or things like that for shelter, you know, for alternatives, let's say. And in that case, I began giving this talk mostly to primary school students, but some secondary school students, but I've given it to regular broad audiences and it always works. And the gist of the talk is the following. I first tell them how the astronomers try to find new planets. And you know, it's a lot of work, it's hard. Again, change. When I was an undergrad student, I think the first planet had just been discovered, the first extrasolar planet had been discovered. This happened in the 90s. And it was by, you know, passing in front of the star and they saw the light curve. That dimmed the light of the star. So that technique had just been successful for the first time mm-hmm. in the 90s, right? But every time I give this talk, I have to update the number of planets that are confirmed. we must be on the 4,000 something at this point. But I gave it from 1 year to the other, and there's dozens to 100 more, right? So I mean, that is a humongous change, even like philosophical. I've seen astronomers arguing, oh my God, are most of the planets out there the size of Jupiter and very close to their stars? Because that's what we were finding at the beginning. Because the technique that we had to find them, those were the ones that were jumping out.
Yeah.
And by now we know that, okay, well, as soon as we move to bigger timelines, other techniques, more sensitive telescopes and instruments and all of that, no, those are not the most famous planets. We did not, you know, you start with your own solar system. So for us, it was like, oh my God, that thing looks so different than ours, right? So for example, now we know that there are planets around almost every type of star. Essentially, it's not that some stars are more likely to have planets than others. They do tend to have more stars if they are more contaminated, in the sense that if they are second, third, or fourth generation stars.
Okay.
But that makes sense. You have more of the elements that you need to make the planet. So that none of that is a surprise, right? Things are easy to clump if you have more dirt.
Yes.
Of some sort, right? So we've been finding all these trends, but the configuration of specific solar systems are incredibly varied. You know, you have some of the really heavy stuff inside. You may have the lighter stuff outside, for example. That's very different to ours, but it may be the case. We have found a handful of other systems that have as many planets as we do. But again, the little planets in our solar system are exceedingly hard to find. We would not have found a Mercury or a Venus or a Pluto at all at this point. Even a Mars is a push, if you ask me. So Earth-like planets, remember I told you we had about 4,000 of them? Well, mm-hmm. Earth-like planets, there's a dozen and a half of them. So, right, you start from a humongous sample, and by the time you go to one like ours.
And Earth-like, what does it mean, Earth-like?
I'm about to explain. What is deemed as Earth-like is mainly two things. That is rocky, so that it's a hard planet that, like I told the kids, it has a floor.
Yes, no gas.
Unlike a gaseous planet like, you know, Jupiter or Saturn or any of those. So that's condition number one. And condition number two, that its orbit is at a distance from the star where it can have liquid water.
Not too close, not too far.
Not too close, not too far. That still doesn't say anything about the atmosphere or the chemistry or anything. So from far away, Mars and Venus look like Earth.
There are some techniques that can determine also compounds in the atmosphere.
They're working on that, and they're doing remarkable work, but that's at the infancy. They literally, those right. measurements are starting to happen in the last 4 or 5 years at most. Mm-hmm. So it's fantastic. We have a professor here that does exactly that. And I drool when I see her talks because I'm amazed at what they can do, but it's still really early, right? And it needs so many things to be right. It needs to be a planet that is close enough to us, where the star is not too bright that it blinds you, where the transits are fast enough that you can follow them with the right equipment, that the orbit is not too tilted.
Yes.
So by the time you get to that, it's a handful of planets that they're doing a remarkable job studying, but it's literally, I would be surprised if it's a dozen of them at this point.
We are talking about stars within our galaxy, evidently.
Yes, not only within our galaxy, near us. Like most of the stars are, I'm talking hundreds of light years from us.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because we don't have the technology. I mean, for sure, I can assure you that the stars on the other side of the galaxy have planets too. And most likely similar to the distribution that we have here. It's just we don't have the instruments to observe.
Yeah.
So all of that happens with really close stars. But then let's go down to the numbers. We say we have 12 to 20 something terrestrial planets. But like I said, from far away, somebody's looking at our solar system, and Mars and Venus count among those. Venus has a thick, incredibly poisonous atmosphere. We don't know why Venus ended up in that stage, super hot. You know, it must be like the hottest steam bath on the solar system is in Venus, and like I said, very poisonous. And then Mars next door, again, they're very similar to Earth in many ways, from far away, very similar. That one lost its atmosphere. It did have water at some point. It must have had an atmosphere, and it went away. Mm-hmm. And right now, that's why we're sending beautiful little cars to Mars to figure out if it's the magnetic field, if it's the soil, if it was the tectonics, we don't know, right?
Yes.
So from far away, how do we tell if those things that we're looking at promisingly are like Earth or like Mars or like Venus? They're working on that, but they are hoping that as soon as the technology gets better, for example, the new space telescope that will be launched in a couple of months, and we're already counting on that, that one may be able to give much better signatures, for at least be able to tell between, this is all sand, there is something like an ocean there, mm-hmm. there may be trees, because there's these broad signatures that foliage mm-hmm. may give, that only foliage can give, for example. So if we get to that, and I think at this point, we may be able to get to that, that will be crazy, wonderful, exciting. Like the tools to get to that for, again, a handful of planets, maybe close, but that may happen in my lifetime.
Yeah, no, for this, it's interesting because the idea of long-term thinking, you know, going back to the start of our conversation, is we're talking about time that is ridiculously big. It's ways beyond, goes way beyond what we can possibly even imagine us as humans having anything to do with. We can just barely comprehend, and that's pretty much it. And then you're talking about other type of length in terms of not only space but also in time, that we do have the capacity to, you know, understand deeper and probably influence more. And then that idea of influence gets me to the next topic, this next concept about limits. Especially in the field that I do research, limits is a contagious thing because as a product designer, we create things to fit into the system, you know, consumerism, production of things that we use and then we discard because that's how it's built. I'm not going to get into economics now, but there is a very complicated issue with the limits. This idea of continuous growth on our economy. Then talking about limits in these huge scales. First of all, the idea of infinite universe, we have in other situations also mentioned that I like normally to mention this to my students as well as a concept. No, there is no really evidence of that anything physical is infinite. We just have theories. But then bringing that down to this level that you were talking about, planets, exoplanets nearby, and we understand if they have atmosphere and so on. What does limits again means to you and us for our understanding of the neighborhood we live in?
This ties beautifully with the second part of this talk that I'm telling you that I do for people. Once I show to them what we know of what's out there and how many things we can look at and what looks promising and whatever, then I go to the part of scales and I say, this is a solar system. This is the sun. And then you have all the other planets. And let's assume that this meter, and normally, if you use a room of say 10 meters, I think most of us can imagine 10 meters. So it's a bigger room, it will be like a big classroom or a library or something like that. But a room that size, I say, this wall is the sun. Then Mercury would be here and Venus would be here and blah, 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 blah. Mars would be here and Jupiter is 2 meters down, right? So the scales, most people don't understand how empty space is, right? And how much room there is in between things. And just because now we can launch little cameras and wonderful instruments to check on these things, they're still really far away. And the issue is, by the time you get to Pluto, you are 10 meters, right? It took us on the order of, I forgot the exact number, but it's between 15 and 20 years to send the fastest spacecraft that humanity has ever launched into space to go take photos of Pluto. You remember those beautiful photos that it took. Now, it had to take them like this very fast because the only way to get there fast enough for, like, imagine the poor people, they're doing this as a project of life and then you have to sit for 15 years or 18 years or whatever and wait for the photos to come back. I mean, it's crazy. So that's why they had to use the fastest, you know, the dynamical slingshot ways and rocket and whatever have you to get the thing fast enough in a matter of decades, right?
Yeah.
And it soon passed the planet because it was going so fast. There was no way that it could stop and do anything. It soon passed. But again, that is the highest achievement that humanity has done to put a piece of thing that we make on Earth to put on space. It's tiny because it has cameras and a couple of instruments, and it made it all the way to Pluto in 20 years. In that scale of room, the next start over would be at the edge of the city, right? The next stellar system, Proxima Centauri, it's roughly at the edge of the city. Depends on the city, but something like that. So I normally do this scale for, you know, if I'm talking in Mexico City, I tell them it's in this mountain, it's in Alajusco or whatever have you.
Yes. Right?
So the chances that we can ever get to any of the things that we beautifully observe at with telescopes and da-da-da-da-da and all these atmospheres that we talk about and foliage, it doesn't exist. Like it's so far away,
yes,
from the capabilities that we need to scale down this notion that there are alternatives for us in the universe, right?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I wanted to go next. This idea of obviously space exploration and humans beyond Earth. There is so much hype now. We are recording this in October 13th, 2021. And just this morning was Blue Origin second space, manned rocket sent to space with Captain Kirk. It was obviously super important moment on human history.
Very symbolic.
Symbolic. Yes, I agree. But there is a lot of hype with this idea of a space exploration, and especially NASA and SpaceX with the idea of going to Mars. So obviously I'm all for it. No, I'm all for exploring and going to Mars. But the important thing with understanding the limits of what actually means going there and what actually means taking that as an option B for a planet that we can run into if we trash the one we have. So if you could explore a little bit those two mm-hmm. ideas.
So one thing that is, I don't understand that most people understand, maybe they explain it to you and you forget, because I've seen a lot of people not grasping this concept. We recently managed to be lucky enough to go to Houston and take my son to see the rockets, in particularly the Saturn V. And you know, you see it in the movies and you see the little models and he had the toys, but nothing prepares you for the scale of this thing.
Massive.
Just this massive, it's a gigantic building and you see it. And when you're there, you understand, look, this first humongous thing, which is the size of a whole building, was just a thing to get them for the first 10 seconds. They got rid of it. Then they ignite the next thing that does the next 2 minutes or something like that. And in the end, when you get to the tip of the thing, is this the tiny piece that had the capsule where the three guys were like this for all the Apollo missions, right? It's super expensive to launch stuff, right? So you only can do it by expending a lot of it. That's why it is a big deal that now they have reusable rockets, because, you know, it was a massive expense to just be dumping all this material.
Yes.
Without being able to use it again. But it doesn't scale infinitely large. Like already the Dragon one that they sent is very impressive to me. But it's still not as powerful as that rocket. And that was just to take them to the moon. Right? So escaping the gravitational pull of Earth requires a huge amount of fuel. That's just the way it is. That's why they left one guy going around the moon while the other two went there. Because they couldn't have taken the whole thing. They had to take this tiny thing. And the moon has far less gravity than Earth. And even then, like the whole endeavor was very energetically complicated. So if you want to even begin to think, honestly, we could think about Mars, but even for the moon, say, let's make a moon base. And maybe from there, we can move to something else. Even that would be so difficult, because how do you keep getting people out of the moon? Like the amount of stuff that you have to carry just in order to jump out is very big. So you would have to make a lot of, let me save all this stuff before I can start putting even three people here, right? Now, if you scale that to Mars, it's inconceivable to me. I don't understand.
Yeah.
It doesn't scale and it doesn't work.
I think it's important. It's important to say, because in my mind, I was imagining some of our audience thinking, yeah, but you know, Saturn V had a computer the size of, you know, a room as well, but maybe not that big, but The classical thing that we hear nowadays that our mobile phones are much powerful as computers, processing power that the computer that Saturn V had. And yes, obviously, no, but that doesn't mean that still the power necessary.
Newton and gravity does not care about your computing power.
Exactly.
And weight
exactly.
is weight. And
technology. You know, this idea of I forgot the name of the this law that says that technology increases speed, development speed every
and I forgot decade. The name too, but it's a law that has held.
Yeah, for sure. But that does not change gravity. Exactly. And that does not change the requirement of, you know, X amount of energy. And so far, the only energy we have is fuel. It's rocket fuel to get us up in space. So that is an important limit, obviously. There are others, many for sure, but one that I would like to hear you talk about is the idea of humans in space for long periods of time. Again, thinking long term. As far as I know, the record is held by a Russian and he's been there for 2 years. Something like that.
It was more than a year. I don't know if it was that close to 2 years because that sounds like
a year and a half, almost 2 years. Anyway, the radiation is one of the main issues that I have heard. Mm-hmm. There are so many other hurdles. I mean, we still have to eat, we still have to drink, we still have to go to the toilet and so on. And people don't realize the huge amount of effort that requires maintaining one human being in one space station.
Tiny space station. Yeah.
A small space station, 400 mm-hmm. kilometers away from Earth. Mm-hmm. So just thinking about these different limits that we have for our human nature, no radiation, space radiation. Again, feasibility and the logics of thinking, you know, let's go to Mars. Let's stay mm-hmm. 6 months in space, just traveling.
Well, no, because that's the thing. For Mars, you're looking at a couple years. I think the trip to Mars would take on the order of, because again, you cannot just go like with a camera as we have been sending the things, and those take 8 months in the best laid out, maybe close to a year. So if you send something with like actual people with the weight that implies, you're looking at a couple years. So
we haven't gotten
Yes, exactly. Because you don't have the energy to send things any faster. They're heavy, right?
Yeah.
So first of all, you would have to be sending things first to have there. Like, imagine carrying water, just water to drink. I mean, the expense of that water is heavy.
Yes.
That's why they are so desperately going to see if like, oh, if I drag and maybe I get this bit of ice, maybe I can do something with it. That would be a thing to try. But so it would be a long time. For the people in the space station, there are little things. I mean, there are things that you can always put a better coding system, something. That worries me. Radiation worries me a little less in the sense that I can see how technology could evolve for that. I'm not saying it's trivial, but it looks feasible. I think the loss of bone density is more of an issue.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They have been working very hard with that in the space station with these exercise machines. I don't know if you know the one called the Colbert, which is it's a sophisticated treadmill. Essentially.
Treadmill, yeah, I've seen.
But it's more than a treadmill because they also bend and push and do. So
yeah,
it does all the muscles and all the parts of the body, not just the running part. But they have been able to improve things a little bit that way, like the bone density is not horrendously affected. It's a little less affected than it used to be if they do these exercises, but that only goes so far. Like it doesn't push the limit times two or times three. One, and the other one has to do, maybe that's the one you were talking about, radiation, the telomeres. Eventually you may talk to biologists and they may tell you better about that, but that one is worrisome. But can I talk about one more thing? This is a completely separate mindset. I once heard a talk and I was thinking the anecdote was that a professor, an astronomy professor, showed up to give a talk. I don't even remember what the original topic was. Maybe it was a variable star or something like that, or some variable, a very interesting object. But he showed up and said, okay, I do have this talk that I said I would give, the one with the variable star, whatever, but I do have another very like more exotic topic that is about Dyson spheres and that sort of thing. And maybe you want to hear that. And you know, most of the arms in the room said, yes, I want to hear the weird one. And that's the one he gave, but one professor got very angry and left. He didn't even stay for the talk. And I have to say, that talk is one of the best talks that I've heard in my life. And I will try to simplify. He went into a lot of detail in all the arguments I'm going to tell you. I'm going to try to simplify as much as possible. But it ties to thermodynamics again. And it is the very basic thinking. It's like, you can divide civilizations between the ones that have the technology to like get out of their planet. We are there already, right? But still, only at the level of sending little cameras and going very nearby. There's a huge leap from that to going to the nearby star. The thing is, once you can travel to a nearby star, it's just as traveling through the neighborhood. Let's assume that you have solved that energetic problem. But what he said is, we may be able to do things a lot better for exploration of the solar system, blah, 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 with the resources we have now, like with the stuff we have in the planet. We may be able to do fusion energy. And in that case, a glass of water will take you to Mars. And, you know, again, I'm not sure this is going to happen in my lifetime, but it's conceivable that it could happen. But he says, but the amount of energy that you need to go to another star requires that you harness the energy of your own star. You cannot do it just with the water on your ocean or whatever. It's not enough, right? So for that, you need to build something that some people call them Dyson spheres, but it's things that capture the energy of the star.
Yes.
They don't necessarily need to be a sphere. They don't need to cover the whole thing. They don't need to blah, blah, blah. But they need to be very big structures, like the size of planetary orbits type of thing, right?
Which we don't have. We all have seen these type of things in science fiction, no? And we have seen all the ships and things, but it's very important to you know, we all fell in love with these technologies and these ideas. But there is a need to be realistic in what can we actually build,
but wait,
with the amount, simply the amount of matter that we have.
Exactly. Like even the whatever you do to make the sheets that will be gathering the energy, I'm not sure you have it on your planet. So you get into already a lot of very difficult arguments. But there's this more thing. Assuming that the laws of thermodynamics apply in the whole universe, and so far they have, as far as we can tell, from the jets of black holes to supernova explosions to whatever, some basic laws of thermodynamics hold, this thing gives off crash radiation. We don't have infinitely efficient systems. We haven't built one, and we don't think it's possible. You could have super efficient ones, then they only have a 10% leak, thermal leak. But like, here's the thing, you don't move a car without producing heat. It doesn't happen, right? You're much more efficient with an electric car, but still it produces heat. And your tires get worn out and things happen. Like the energy cannot be completely translated into the moving, right?
Yes.
So this signature, even if you are super generous and say, let's assume that things are, let's say, 90% efficient. Let's assume an average star. Let's assume, making very basic assumptions, they say the thermal signature of this, you know, the thing that you cannot, because you're not 100% efficient, would be so visible. It will be glaringly obvious. See, if there was in our galaxy, or even in nearby galaxies, a civilization that had already come up with some sort of Dyson sphere with enough energy to harness from their own star to go to nearby stars, the signature, just this thermal trash, nothing else. They can be stealth and wonderful in their communications and you don't see them. But the thermal part is exceedingly hard to hide. Mm-hmm. And we haven't seen it, and we at this point have the instruments to have seen it. Yes. Which brings you to, wow, at least in our galaxy and nearby, let's say Andromeda and some galaxies nearby, it's hard to say. I mean, there's probably not a civilization that has done this.
Yes.
You don't go from there to say nowhere in the universe, but certain, like, unless we're missing something, and there's always a possibility, like I told you, we science change and the things that we know change, and Einstein came and revolutionized everything we knew, so I'm not putting it past it. But with assumptions that with the tools that we have now, we couldn't hide that level of energy transformation, right?
And I guess that's one bit that I would like to use to almost end our conversation is the idea of striking a balance, you know, between what we can do, what we can expect to do with our technology, and knowing that we evolve our technologies really fast. So my worry is here for our audience to think that we are against technology and we're against all these things. And obviously, no, we are absolutely in pro of all these things, but we need to be realistic in the terms of this limit that we can actually break. So the balance is between the technology and what we can expect from our development of technology and the limits that the universe imposes on us and our human nature. And I have a few theories and ideas, but I won't get there now because I will talk about it later in another episode. But the last thing, just going back to this idea of Planet B as an option, one of the limits that a couple of them that I heard of, and I just want for you to tell me if I'm completely crazy or there is something there. One of them is in Mars specifically, that is like the objective that at least NASA and SpaceX have, and probably Chinese and others as well. The atmosphere, the idea that we can terraform or engineer the atmosphere. Let's just go back a little bit. Is ask first, how is it that it lost its atmosphere in the beginning and the first time? Because we can engineer it and we can make it, but what will guarantee that we'll stay that way? So how Mars lost its atmosphere, do we know?
That is an open problem, as far as I know. I'm not a planetary scientist, so maybe there are better theories than what I have, but I think part of it has to do with the fact that its magnetic field is a lot is weaker and not a range like ours is like literally a dipole. It's like a mega magnet. So there's a bunch of things that happen because of that processes in the upper atmosphere that help. There's shielding of solar radiation and a bunch of things that happen because we have a magnetic field of the size that we have. Now, one thing on Earth, it has changed polarity. And until we figure out why that happens, that may be an issue. Because we don't know what happens in between. We know that it has happened for sure, like the geological record is there. So in the case of Mars, what if it's the same thing that, it reverses until it gets weak enough that it fizzles out? Mm-hmm. Maybe it's connected to that. Maybe it was a process that just was faster in Mars because it's smaller and maybe the core cooled down faster than it did for Earth. So you need a core that lives a certain amount of time to the fact of a ferromagnetic core that when you spin, it gives you this nicely organized magnetic field. It may have something to do with that. I may be making it up, but that's what I remember hearing.
Yes.
So in terms of terraforming, you have a point because if you don't have this magnetic field to deflect the solar radiation that does things to you, even if you manage to come up with an atmosphere, it may evaporate very quickly and you don't want that.
That will mean that for us to take enough humans there to establish their permanent post will require obviously much more
than a few potatoes, yes.
Yeah, equipment and things, and not only growing potatoes. So the last bit will be, I guess, just to mention the idea of moving away from our planet as a planet B, as an option B, whatever Mars or whatever else. This is from a more kind of a biological aspect. I know it's not your field, but just to maintain a healthy population in terms of diversity in DNA, I was reading some interesting research by some biologists. They were saying that the minimum will be around 10,000 individuals to maintain a diversity pool of enough diversity pool of DNA to maintain us healthy. How do we take 10,000 humans to Mars?
That's a huge amount of people. I'm telling you, I don't think we can do anything meaningful in Mars until we establish a colony in the moon for various reasons. And I think that's the only way to actually think of Mars is go through the moon for various reasons. We need to learn mining. We need to learn being in an unprotected environment for a while, how the individual steps. It's so far away that I think, and again, that's what I really like about The Martian, the movie.
Yes.
Because it explains very well, like in this case, you already your basic assumption already fantastic. Like they have a nice little rocket Earth already standing there for living, and they have a an already established habitat, and like many things are already super rosy. And even then, this poor guy almost gets to the bones, right? With, with all the knowledge and all of that. So not 10,000 seems completely unrealistic.
So is unrealistic today? It's unrealistic with the technology and resources that we have today. That's why, obviously, the idea to go back to the moon to start exploring the possibility of settling first there, so we can then go further away with enough energy, and the energy will be less necessary, less to get us there, but also the equipment and so on. So yeah, I mean, that's the path to go for sure, and I am all for it. My main worry is that we should not see it as an option B. And even if it gets to be an option B, it will take much more time than we may think of.
And there's also the ethical part of you could have done better at home.
Exactly. Like,
what right do you have to just go in and stomping in other places? They're not yours. Right?
That's an excellent point. I wasn't actually thinking of talking about that, but if you have time, I've been having some issues with the ethics of space exploration, and started basically with this Starlink satellite that SpaceX sent. Probably in another moment I mentioned, not in this podcast, in a previous moment, Dr. Noyola and I, we know each other for a while. I like to take photos of the dark, the night sky. You know, it's my really, really tiny steps, baby steps in astrophotography. And the Starlink is horrible. You know, it's just a crime from my perspective.
It gives me a headache. I hate it. There's a lot of astronomers that are very heavily
I know.
Trying to work. The main issue is there's a discussion to be had about the equity of bringing internet to areas that are not going to have it in any feasible manner in any time soon, because they're really far away and they're really unpopulated. And so I'm not disdaining that. It's not that it doesn't matter.
Yeah, of course.
But that said, jumping onto something like that without even asking?
Yes.
It's like we really miss the mark here, in the sense of kind of like we're behaving like Columbus in a way, right?
Yes.
Like this one kingdom decides that this one guy is going to go do some exploration, and the consequences end up being gigantic, and nobody asks the other side, and nobody even asks the other kingdoms, right?
Yes.
And it's sort of the same thing. I mean, nobody asks, well, certainly the astronomers, but not even the space scientists. You know, there's a name for this possible situation of a cascade effect where some piece of debris goes off where it should and it destroys most low orbit satellites. So my point is there's many things to take care of, not only astronomy, but space. It's still kind of empty and unclaimed, even though by now it's full of junk and there have been some incidents there that are not that easy. Like a loose bolt can do a lot of damage to some very, very useful piece of information for a given country or a piece of science or something like that. So I hate this thing of like, because I can, I will, and I won't bother to talk to people. And they're trying to say, oh, well, if I paint my satellites black, is that better?
I heard that last month, I think I heard that, and it's like, no.
The tragedy for the optical astronomers is that in twilight and sunrise, let's say in the edge of the night, those things are crazy visible. Like they really will ruin your observations. And there's some observations that are very valuable exactly at that time of the day. For example, comets and certain asteroids, things that are near to us, but they're, you know, just because of their nature and blah, blah, blah. I'm not sure you will be able to do these things if you have a net, you know, of bright things just at the time when you can observe these things, number one. But number two, you're taking, shaving off a solid hour on both ends of the night. And, you know, if you're planning a survey, you're counting in your night weeks as long as they are and as useful as they are for calibrations and for all of this. You have to get rid of 2 hours of your observational night. I mean, that, I mean, we're building the Vera Rubin Observatory. It's gigantic. It's very expensive. We're spending a huge amount of money on that, and it's going to be fantastic. Are you shaving off literally 2 hours of their observation every day on account of this thing that nobody asked you if it would affect you?
Yeah, yeah. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. I think the problem with ethics in space exploration, I think you made a wonderful analogy with Columbus. No, is the idea of also learning from our previous mistakes and think it twice. No, what is it that we're doing and who are we representing and asking for, you know, what to do? I'll be hopefully I'll be chatting with a philosopher. Because this is a crucial point as well, no? And connects also interestingly with indigenous knowledge. So I hope to get also a guest from indigenous background to help us a little bit understand. I've been living in Canada for the last 7 years, and I have learned a great deal of First Nations here. And one of the things that really struck me is that decision making takes time. And, you know, settlers took that as a negative view. They wanted to move fast because they wanted, you know, to do the commerce as fast and make as much money as possible. But the idea of, as far as I understand it, the First Nations decision-making process is precisely to consider all opinions and to go and ask all different parties, individuals that are somehow related, to hear from them and to understand what you know, what is their view and what is their impact.
Of course.
And I think that is kind of a Western way of doing things that we need to really recalculate and rethink. But anyway, I know this is going a bit off topic, but it's an important thing. And the whole idea of this podcast is precisely to see, you know, how some things connect to other things and how we cannot just solve a complex problem by looking at it from one lens, no? So anyway, I'm going to close this with three questions that I will do to all my guests. And one of them is more or less like this. I did my research, and I'm not a biologist, but I found that the longest living species are cyanobacteria. And they have lived for more than 2 billion years, billion with a B. We humans have been around like 200,000 years. And we are already putting in danger our own existence with our own making. So from your perspective, you know, with this big, you know, astronomy approach that you have, what do you think we need to do or stop doing to even dream to be a successful species as cyanobacteria or many others that have been going on for much longer than us? Complicated question.
It's a very complicated question, but I'll give what I hope it's a relatively short answer. We need to understand the technical arguments better. So that doesn't mean that everybody has to be an engineer or a scientist or a mathematician or anything like that, but it means that the basic education is to be at a level where anybody can read a very simple plot or a very simple set of figures, or even go find, you know, the set of figures that are reasonable to make decisions. And those are your everyday decisions. What product do you buy to do something? How do you renew your house? What car do you buy? Do you buy a car, or where do you move to? All these type of things. If you don't have access to the technical knowledge, I'm not sure that I can blame you for making horrendous choices.
Yeah.
Right? Because you didn't even know. And now we're seeing the horrendous consequences of not having access to this technical knowledge with the pandemic, right? The number of people making absolutely atrocious choices simply because it's easier to listen to the neighbor or my aunt than to actually do the research.
Yeah.
Real research or whatever, to process the argument. You don't even need to do the research. You need to process an argument, you know.
I agree. There is a bit of polemic, talking from my perspective as a product designer, as industrial designer. There has been quite a lot of polemic thinking, okay, do we change behavior, human behavior, or should we just give people the choices that are already sustainable. And in the last 20 years, there's been quite a lot of research. And for what I know, changing behavior is not an easy thing. So there is a what I think is a more logical approach, at least with a bit of faster results. If we understand that the needs or the things that we would like people to do, it's not that because they don't want it to do, it's because they don't have options to do it. Mm-hmm. Talking about what you were mentioning about products and cars and things mm-hmm. That at the end is all those things adding up is getting us into this really, really complicated situation that we are living now, and we will face in the next few decades. And that also connects to the second question, the second final question, about the importance of failure in discovery. I have this idea that some of the problems that we have is because, and I'm bringing this up from what you mentioned about the pandemic and all the different polemic around masks or no masks and vaccines or no vaccines. And I think one of the problems is that scientists were informing politicians, and the way that we understand, we gather knowledge and we get to understand what's going on is not straightforward and it's not linear. It's not something that you learn and then that's it. It's written in stone and that will never change. So scientific knowledge, scientific understanding and the creation of knowledge is an iterative process that takes error by default, is the logic in it. So from again, your understanding, your field, what is the importance of failure in discovery and human progress?
This is a cliche because everybody has said it a million times, from Steve Jobs to who knows who, but you so often learn much, either more valuable lessons or more stuff from your failures and from your successes, right? For me, always, the most valuable comes from, we call it banging yourself on the wall, but it's kind of, it's a trial and error. There's no thing, error is part of that equation. There's no way around it, right? So it is fundamental. It's indivisible from knowledge and from technical knowledge, from anything, from any professional activity, I would say, any. And I'm talking about a gardener, and I'm talking about a, construction worker, a cleaner person, anybody. There's no professional activity that doesn't go by, I shouldn't have used this thing to dissolve that because it doesn't work. So to me, it's so indivisible that it is mind-boggling to me that we demonize it as much as we do, right?
Yeah.
Like in school, it certainly should be. I think things are beginning slowly a little more modern, and I think teachers are no longer as strict as they used to be. And even from my schooling to my children's schooling, I've seen positive change in that case. So I'm not saying there's no change, but it's too slow. I think they are still doing standardized testing and all these things that, I don't know, they're problematic. My main concern is, for me, so obviously clear that there's a lot of value in making mistakes, that we should just reframe the way we think about it,
of course,
the way we describe it, the way we share with other people and all of this.
Why? I know this is more kind of a personal question. It's not necessarily related to astrophysics, but why is the reason? What will be the reason why we then suddenly are so afraid of failure? What has happened? Why we punish failure in so many other contexts?
It's a cultural trait. I think we have made it a cultural trait, and it's a cultural trait that has been going on for a very long time, right? I don't know, since the time of the Romans, I'm pretty sure there were people that were already writing about this and the horror of failing on whatever their personal goals were, right? I've read a lot of novelized history or things like that about Romans, and for them, for example, their legacy or their time beyond this earth or whatever, that was the goal. And failing at that, like if they didn't get to do whatever it was that they wanted to do, because there were different versions of this, was simply horrendously dissatisfying. So my point is, this fear has been there already for a long time. It's a cultural thing, and it's very hard to change. It's like the fear of others. You know, I fail to see, we know from children's psychology that we're not born with that.
Yes.
This gets ingrained on us. And I think it's the same type of process. We grow up with this, slap you if you didn't do it correctly. Why didn't you get to the potty on time? See,
yes.
It starts from a very early time. So we really have to reframe it. It's very difficult. It's not easy. It's very ingrained in us. But it is cultural, I think.
Yeah, I agree for sure. I'm scheduling my interview with a psychologist. So let's see what cognition and cognitive bias has to say about that. Because yes, absolutely, it's a long thing that we've been struggling with, and we really need to change that. So the very last question, and is just for you to, you know, dream as far as you want. What will be the future of your choosing? So what will be the ideal future? And you can go as far away in the future as you want, 1,000 years, 10,000 years, or 100 years if you want, if you don't want to go that far. I understand the long term is super interesting, what we discussed a while ago. So the first is how long will you go, and how that wonderful, interesting, perfect, or not perfect, but ideal future will be for you?
Oh my God. The problem is that I have a hard time thinking of, I'll pick the 1,001 because I'm a coward. Like I can even think of 100, but let's pick the 1,000. I really, call me idealistic, but I would really love it that we finally understand that the divisions among us are non-relevant, simply not relevant. Whatever you want to call them, the borders, color of skin, gender, you name it. Those things are absolutely irrelevant. And we spend copious amount of time, energy, resources dealing with exactly these divisions. And in my ideal worldview, I think whatever it is that humanity wants to do by that time, or can do by that time, whatever is left, understand that these divisions are a massive waste of time, really. They're mostly a waste of time. So that should impact everything. It should impact these cultural issues, it should impact technology. Like, I want diversity to be there, of course. That's what makes us human. And I value diversity, but the sorting is the part that bothers me. It's not the existence of diversity is the part that we need to put things in boxes. Humans in boxes. So, mm-hmm. So some things do need to put in boxes for you to deal with them. But humans, this need for to put humans in boxes, like I tell you, educationally, economically, geographically, it's costly. It's very, very costly. So I hope that whatever we're doing in 1,000 years, and again, it could be the Mad Max version of this. I hope it's not.
I hope
it's not. In an ideal world, it would be the Star Trek version of this. You know?
Excellent. Thank you. You want to add anything else?
Thank you for this. It was very, very interesting. And it's an unusual way for me to think about the things that I normally go through in a regular day. So I really like it. I thank you for that, because
that's my idea. that's my idea, precisely, to talk about things that more probably we normally don't talk about. But it will be interesting. I mean, this is a whole experience, an exploration for me as well. So what I hope I'll do is, you know, as soon as these episodes are published, I hope you will join us an audience as well and hear the other guests talk. And who knows, maybe we can come back in season two and have a second discussion and move forward these ideas and how things connect. Because certainly there is no one single expert that has the answer for everything. No,
oh, absolutely not.
We really need to start building bridges and work together.
I can't wait. I'm super interested to know what people from other walks of life are gonna say around these topics.
Excellent. Okay, we will be in touch for sure. Eva, Dr. Noyola, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much for the invitation again.
I would like to end this episode with a few reflections and a few key points to take away.
I certainly enjoy the conversation, and I learn a lot, and I discover how wrong I was in a few things. But that's the whole point. And I guess starting with change, that yes, it is a constant in the universe, but in these very large scale things, as the universe or even galaxies, change takes a lot of time. And the way that we have learned how to understand that is just fascinating. So I think it's much more interesting to think about how is it that we change our understanding of the universe and all the different things that happen in it. The other point was the balloon analogy that I proposed, and I'm still struggling to understand. It's just mind blowing, talking about the curvature of the universe, and there is no special place and there is no center. I have read a little bit afterwards, and I still need to read more. I still need to understand a bit more, but it's quite interesting. In my view, as a designer, it's a very rigid, like three-dimensional. I may be lacking imagination, but I still find it fascinating. The other point that I think we didn't touch was we discussed about dark matter and dark energy. But it turns out that dark matter represents around 27% of the entire universe. And dark energy is even more, it's 68%. That's what we know today, and it's just mind-blowing. I found that 5% of the universe is what we can actually observe with the instruments that we have produced. So there is still tons of things to understand. And this idea that, as we recently understood about dark matter and dark energy, we yet not know exactly what happens with this through time. Mm-hmm. So it's something that, yeah, is really fascinating. In relation to long-term thinking, that makes more sense to think about planetary systems. It's similar to what I was saying before. To large scale, it makes really no sense. And again, how fast are we learning? And that this long-term thinking relates much more to our, let's say, neighborhood, no, and the things that are closer to us. And because of our nature and the limits we have, is more relatable, I guess. And that relates to these limits and the travel in space, no, that it is all about energy and the speed and the resources and equipment that you need to go. Interesting the idea of this Dyson sphere and this thermal signature, that because of this, it needs to be so big that we have not yet found any trace of this. So there is no civilization, at least, that has arrived to that point. I guess we could be the first. I guess we just need to solve some immediate challenges, that we have in our planet. And that takes me to the final point, no? That is this idea of colonization of space and the planet B. I think it's unethically and unrealistic to give up on Earth and to think on planet B as an option. We can certainly achieve great things, and I agree with this idea of go first to the moon and then go to Mars through that kind of gate in the moon. First as exploration, hardly as a permanent settlement. And thinking about, you know, terms of time and the development of technology, yes, yeah, sure, we certainly will be able to go beyond that. But then comes these ethical implications, no, of who represents and who decides and who does in the name of all in humanity. And what are we going to do and what for? No, I think it is absolutely relevant to have these conversations and to really stop and think, you know, what is it that we want to do and what is the purpose of doing it? Who is leading the charge, and have we all been consulted? And I understand that is a very large planet with so many people, but still, I think we still need to go through a little bit of thinking process there and reflect on these topics. So whatever we want to do out there, we need to first get our home in order. That's the final reflection. The challenges related to climate change that we have right now is really our main limit if we really want to go to Mars and we want to, in whoever, whatever amount of time, build a colony over there, for whatever reasons, we still need to settle our home, fix the problems that we have here, and then think beyond.
Future Exploration is produced and written by me, Victor Martinez. Music is composed by Rafael Crux, Udayana Lugo, and Mauro and Daniel Martinez. Future Exploration is licensed under the Creative Commons with Attribution and Non-Commercial Use.